seminars, symposium, talks, or I don't know around the speakers, has been very helpful in cushioning the negative part of that poor typographical presentation. And in the Philippines, we have people who are great speakers. And I know many dioceses have really organized seminars, especially about Evangelii and Laudato Si, and Amoris Laetitia, and parishes have organized seminars. That's what should be done. Now the question is that many times, many resource people are not available, and this is where Word and Life has come in. Produces something that is not of a scholarly nature. We are not for that. We are not for that. It would be nice, but what people need, what the Catholics need, is something simpler, almost in lay terms, so that when they talk to people who know very little about their faith, they are not put off by too much theological jargon or technical terms. Okay. Now, the consequences of this limited audience and lack of attractiveness, what are they? Some consequences, okay? Much of the content of these vital documents has remained, to a great extent, unknown to almost all Catholics. I remember that Monsignor Jerry many years ago said that these documents of the Church are the best kept secret. You remember, you said that, I'm sure you said it many times, and everybody nodded in approval. The best kept secret. The consequence of this unattractiveness and the lack of our proper literature. Most of the documents have not been applied to the local situation except for the changes in liturgical disciplinary norms and other external instructions. But the meat is not that. The meat is much more social justice, involvement of the lay people. That would have required much more commitment. Now, they say it's better to light the little candle than to curse the darkness. What is this little candle? The seminars, the round tables, the official launching at the local level, because that's a little light, and it's important. The other light, okay, move on. What a light. Now over the past 10 years or so, it has endeavored to make its contribution to the attainment of the objectives of making church documents better known and their message put into practice. Of course, it's not perfect. We could have done better. We could have done more. But we have also other concerns. So what I have presented to you, you feel free later on to go over it, to have an idea. What the Life has done by preparing the study edition, that's what we call them, study editions, okay, of some of the major documents of the Universal Magisterium issued in recent years. Now, the study edition are usually divided into two parts, any one of the study editions that we have produced. Two parts. The first part reproduces exactly the text of the paper document. The second part is the study aids. Now, why the second consists of a set of study, the second consists in a set of study aids that can vary depending also on the theme developed by the document and the local situation. The study aids are not really uniform. There are some features that are present in all issues, in all books. But in some cases, I have emphasized certain things that I'm not emphasizing others. Okay. So what is present is the subject index, the historical contextualization, and the methodological suggestion that you find in almost all the books published by Word and Life on the documents of the Church. The one that is most often consulted and used is the subject index. I can tell you it takes time to make it. At the beginning when we were preparing the see, it's here to see. Some people in La Salle alone, we take care of the subject index. We do it with a computer. I said, would you? How will you do that? I will see. And then after a few weeks, they come with a pack of things like that. All the entries. Guess what was the most common entry? Can you guess? The. Another one. And. I said, you call this a study subject? And that's what the computer can do. Yes, and I told you, you cannot do it with a computer if you want to produce a subject index that is concept-based. Concept-based. That means that there is a lot of work. It consists in a reading paragraph by paragraph with an analytical view. And then identify the main ideas. And then express those ideas in a very synthetic manner. And write them down. Then the computer can give it a title. What is the main topic? Holy Communion, confession, and so on. Give a title. Then the computer will alphabetize the entries. But the actual wording of the different concepts contained in the subject index, that is the work of the human mind. And there is no substitute for that, I can tell you. It's a very enriching work. There are many degrees of completion and so on, but this is one of the features of the study, the subject index that we prepare. We prepare a very short sentence, and then there may be sub-entries and so on. All the idea is to make sure that the one who uses it finds it right away. This is what I need, and this is the paragraph numbers and so on. You may have seen some subject indexes that are all a series of numbers. All a series of numbers, which makes the whole thing an exercise if you did it. One of those is this one. The compendium of the CCC. The subject index that they prepare, you can view numbers, numbers. Christ, number 1, number 6, number 12, number 45 to 46, 53, 8 lines of numbers. How helpful is that? That is done with the computer. But if I want to know what every number stands for, what does it tell me about Christ, I have to go again there and read it for myself. It may take me quite a time. These are about 60 numbers. And the major entries are that way. The major entries are that way. Jesus Christ, the Church, the Holy Spirit, and so on. What we do is very different. And you can verify it for yourself if you like. So a subject index is very helpful for priests, for people who want to prepare a talk. And everything is arranged, the entries are arranged alphabetically, easy to find. Likewise, when we have in some issues, in some encyclicals, we have used also the quotable quotes. What we did in that was, after reading it, to identify sentences. And what is the topic of this sentence? This one. Then we arrange them alphabetically. Again, you want to give a talk on, I don't know, Bible studies, and see if there is what the encyclical says about that. And you have a series of quotations already prepared for you. Of course, if you want more, it's not exhaustive. Otherwise, we produce a book that is 3 times the size of the original book. That would be already a scholarly work or something for a thesis, but that's not really. We want to offer something very elementary, simple, easy to use. Now the other one is the historical contextualization. What is that? Well, every document of the Church does not come out of the blue. It comes out in a very precise historical context with certain situations or certain anniversaries. Many of the documents the Church, as I mentioned earlier, are issued on the 50th anniversary, say, of the end of Vatican II, or 80th Advent. Why 80th? Because 80 years earlier there was this document. What has the, how the Church has advanced in the theological reflection on those things. No? So, in a very simple manner, we give the background that enables, now I understand why the Pope is emphasizing this. So, this is important. Again, it is at the level not of scholars, but at the level of a very simple, basic information that all Catholics should know. Then, the methodology and suggestions. Yes, we imagine that the catechist or the group facilitator as a group, homogeneous group. How to proceed in studying a document of the Church? How to proceed? What method to follow? What comes first? What comes next? No? The basic idea is that, okay, one can study the doctrine of the Church personally. But in most cases, these things are done within a parish or in a school, in groups. And there are advantages from that, especially at the level of sharing. Because in the sharing, there are different insights. In the discussion, there is a mutual enrichment. All this, you know, contributes to the assimilation, to the deepening of the message of the document. Not only that, but we imagine that we don't just study the document in a vacuum. We study the document in our concrete historical, sociological, religious, even political situation. And we have to see what aspects of our present society, in the Church, in the school environment, and so on, has some relationship to what the document says in this chapter. So again, interaction, sharing. We may identify values, counter values, difficulties, challenges. And so, after discussing the content of the Pope's document, after evaluating our present situation, what is the relationship? How can we cascade the teaching, the message of the Pope's document or of this chapter in our present situation that has these shortcomings of these potentials and so on? All this is done in view of preparing a plan of action. That is one of the features of our methodology suggestions. It is not just trying to know. Knowledge is the basis for action. So it has to be clear. The objective of our study is in view of putting into practice the message of the Holy Family. Then that document becomes life. Then that document can enrich us as individuals, as a group, as a community, as a country. Then that document will not be forgotten the day after we finish reading it. Because it is, its effect will permeate the life of the community. Now if you take this document of Laudato Si, with all extreme sensitivity to the effect of our activity, of what we do on the environment, the moral responsibility, and so on. As I was reading that, and then I was, in a way, reading again the document of the social doctrine of the Church. There is one chapter in that compendium of social doctrine, chapter 10. It's all on ecology. A very beautiful thing, part of which is mentioned here in the story. But then the chapter 10, it's a masterpiece. The question is, have we now read something serious? Are we serious about that? You can already, or if you like, if you still have a copy of it, read again what is happening to our beautiful land, which was accompanied by a series of data. Deforestation, the pollution left by the mining companies and so on. You see, this is ours, produced by our bishops, that may be forgotten about. this is a good incentive for us to revisit what our bishop wrote already 20 years ago. That's all. Okay. Some important clarification, that's the tool. So, the level and style of presentation is not scholarly. The style of presentation is not scholarly. It is simple and as simple as it can be. And you can verify that for yourself. The content of study is not a comprehensive and exhaustive. What do I mean by that? We cannot put everything. It would take too long to prepare. It would make the book much thicker and the cost higher. So we give what we consider really essential. But at the same time, we challenge. If you want to know more, follow this procedure. Read it attentively. Even the subject index, all of you should be able to complete it. As you read it, oh, this is not enough in my subject. I added it. Under this heading, there is also this paragraph that maybe I overlooked it. Add it. That make it your own. You contribute. You share your insight with others. That's mutual enrichment. So much more could be done. For the one, say when it was, for example, this verbum domini. Well, I made a research on what is the word of the Lord there in the Bible. So I need to go over the Bible to identify those passages that are specifically related to the word of God. In this one, Lumen Fidei, I made a special research on faith in the Bible. And it's condensed here, about almost 100 pages. Faith in the Bible. It's not the same everywhere. And you can find the references, the faith of the prophets, the faith of men, the faith of Paul, the faith of the apostles. It was for me a challenge to reflect on that very simple word that we often use indiscriminately, but it has so many nuances. Okay, let me find it. So when we speak of Lumen Fidei and the light of faith, we go back to the sources, and it is extremely enriching. Extremely enriching. Then we can ask, now what's my faith? Is my faith similar to the one of Mary? Is my faith similar to the one of Paul? And so on. There are terrific differences, but all complementing one another, because no one is perfect. Okay, so it's not comprehensive, does not include everything, it's not exhaustive, it does not say everything. It is open to being improved and to be enriched. Now, much is left to the creativity of the local group facilitator, who should always keep in mind also the special audience each of them faces, as well as the special conditions obtaining in each place, parish, town. I feel very strongly about that. Even studying the doctrine of the church, we should always keep in mind where we are. What is my audience? Am I talking to teenagers or am I talking to senior citizens? It's another different word. What they some consider very important, I will emphasize it. I will bring it out from them. That becomes interactive. It is not a lecture where the lecturer speaks for half an hour, 1 hour, depends on how bright he can be, and the others keep it longer, and sometimes they stop longer because of that, doesn't it? The style is interactivity. To get everybody involved as much as possible. And that requires a special technique on the part of the facilitator. Okay. Now, the study session should never become a lecture. I already said something about that. It is not a lecture, there is a facilitator, but he has to facilitate, not to spoon feed through one quotation here, one quotation there, he does almost everything. No, he facilitates, he enables the participants to feel protagonists. in the, this company. Now, the process of this company is very enriching, takes time, but in the end, the people own what they have discovered. It is part of their personal effort in trying to understand, in reflecting, and so on. It's a very important thing that we try to promote through these study aids. Okay? Now, the amendment, can I see the previous one? The study aid session should never become an okay, go ahead. So the study aids are meant to be characterized by, all right, let me see, personal reading of the text, that's important. The participants should read the text. Next. Personal group reflection, sharing on it. So the reading is step A. Step B, reflection, personal reflection, proper time given for that, and then share small groups as much as possible. Depending, if you have 50 people, make it 10 groups of 5 to make sure that everybody gets a chance. Even the shy ones that are the more comfortable in listening, let the small group, there will be somehow forced to say something, and that depends on the facilitator, on the group facilitator, on the cluster facilitator, to really bring everybody in. That's important. And then an analysis of aspects of the local situation which are similar or relevant to the topic that has been developed in the portion of the document that is being studied. I'm studying the document, say, chapter 3, that speaks, I don't know, of pollution or respect for the environment. Okay. Where do we stand now? What's our situation here? What destroys the environment? What can be done to improve the environment? So that is sharing. We examine, we discuss our problem. Then, next step, we bring to bear the teaching of the book on what we have discovered ourselves. We are not discovering everything. Many things are already known, but it's good to bring them together. An analysis of the local situation, okay? And then application of the message to the portion under study to the local or personal situation, application. And there is a whole dynamic explained there in the methodology suggestions. We don't stop in the discussion. What are we going to do about it? We have dissected the major topic into subtopics. What are we going to do about it? Maybe the topics are many, the problems are many. We are not going to save the world in 2 days. Let us select one that make it the focus of our plan of action. Write it down. When we meet the next time, we will report on the what has been done. So it's important to plan action. Next meeting, first thing to do, evaluation on whether or not we were able to apply what we decided to do. If not, why? No, there is a whole, you know, dynamics there. So to show that we are really serious, I can tell you that if this methodology is followed, you will never forget, or our people will never forget that document. Because they put so much of themselves there. So many things were brought to consciousness, let them mean in the subconscious maybe. And we did something, maybe we showed our inability to do something. Why? We should always ask why. Maybe we could have done better. Maybe we wanted to do too much. We have to resize our commitments and so on. We learn from our experience. It's part of the process. Now this is the main reason why all the participants should have their own personal copy of the document as well as a personal note. Two things. So, how many of you have Amoris Laetitia? Almost everyone. Very good. I hope you have this study edition. It's important. If we had the time, we could test this methodology, taking a chapter or a part of a chapter to see how it works, to learn the ropes. So that then you can cascade it to your catechists, maybe to the parish priest and so on, members of the parish pastoral council and so on. So personal copy, so that one can maybe a pencil or a ballpen or whatever, underline the sentence that he considers important or she considers important. The notebook, a personal copy, okay. The notebook, next one, is meant to enable the users to write down personal impression, reaction to the text. In a way, you are creating your own commentary with your notebook. There will not be enough space on every page to write things that you would like to write, otherwise you are destroying also your copy. The copy of the book is for underlining, maybe some arrows connect, and this is also there, that corner, and so on. But the most useful thing, the most creative thing, and the most useful thing to assimilate the message is the personal book. I really encourage all of you to demand that whoever wants to participate in these study sessions should bring the personal book. They will learn a lot. It will become their own document. I want to propose this idea comes to me now, write it down. The next meeting, for the next 15 days, this is our commitment. Write it down, a point of reference. This has tremendous pedagogical advantages. You are a teacher, you are a head of a school, how important it is not to shift from the teacher telling everything to the students and leaving the students to discover for themselves as much as possible. That is what will really stick, what will remain, and what we make of our people, ambassadors, of the bishops, ambassadors of the Pope, in sharing the messages, because they put something on sense. Their life will be changed. We will no longer ask, how come we don't know any more of these documents? One can stand up and say, I know it very well. I attended a course for 7 weeks. I know the ins and outs. How beautiful if every time a church document comes out, for months and months people really make it the focus of their attention. Okay. Now sketch ideas, proposals, and other elements that surface in the discussion, the sharing, both on the content of the text itself and the local situation. The importance of sharing, it's very rich. Some ideas may seem queer, strange, outlandish, but sometimes they prick us and they can generate other ideas that perhaps are better. They are more relevant, more practical. The advantage of participation by all. Okay. Finally, the personal book should contain proposed activities to be carried out, already said. Some remarks on now the front cover on the picture inside. Okay, just some of you are already browsing over this. We make it a point every time there is a document of the church to identify what is the basic idea and what is the basic topic. And we try to reflect it, to portray it on the front cover. On the front cover. Let's see if there is something there. Oh, Evangelii Gaudium. Two ideas, gospel and joy. And we try to reflect it there. This is in color, that's not very appealing. In color. Okay, we try to portray two young people looking at the gospel or under the inspiration of the gospel that produces joy. I think this is much better than simply as Evangelii Gaudium. Evangelii Gaudium. This is four lines. Doesn't say much. The words, yes. Let me see. Laudato si. Deus caritas est. Evangelical on the back. See how inspired.
I'm sorry.
Bishop, don't say that to the people in the Vatican. But if you can, tell them, time to wake up. To learn the ABC of communication and the importance of a cover whenever we produce something so precious, but so insignificant. I cannot even read it. I cannot even read it. St. Francis, okay. This is what we're trying to produce. Francis, we know, is a great patron of ecology, the lover of nature. We try to portray that. I'm not a Franciscan, but I admire Francis. It comes. Let us see. I'm only the special regardless. How that to see? That is not Vatican Publishing House. Doctors of Singapore. And so on. I'm going to make a long story. If you like, go over these things just for you to have some idea. I'm always the teacher. What matters is love and the joy that love produces in the family. The family as God wants it. We chose not just father, mother, and one child. We don't want to promote the one child policy. We self-read that there is more than one child. There's a message to them also. A message. Not one child points. Children, more children than one or more two, they are not a source of worry. They should not be. They are a source of joy. That's the Christian view. It's in the heart. Then they see, I'm always in the essential of everything. And see that the dogs are the same point, quiet. Now for the subject index, well, okay, you see that. Sometimes it is 30, 40 pages even. We believe we have done something useful, but one needs to learn also how to use it. And it is a contribution to the proper use of the document, so as not to get drowned in a document that's already almost 200 pages. One gets drowned. I'm interested in confirmation. Does it say anything about confirmation? Alphabetical order, find it, paragraph, so and so, done. Go and read it for yourself, prepare your talk, prepare an intervention, and so on. And much more enough, if you have a copy yourself, you could go just, but we don't have the time also to do that. That would be just a reminder. The medical suggestors already talked about it, they come to suggestion. Likewise, the quotable quotes, I was not able to use the quotable quotes for every document because sometimes there are so many beautiful sentences that I had 30 pages just for that. So the book would have come to cost more. So you will forgive if I cannot produce the quotable quotes for everyone. But you know, that is where your creativity comes in. As you read it and you like a sentence, by all means, make a note. Later on, make a correction on the same topic. It's in this chapter, in the other chapter, that becomes your quotable quote that you can share with your parishioners, with your subalterns, and so on. Then the documentation. Yeah, the documentation varies. Like, for instance, the one of, Laudato Si. When I was reading Laudato Si, I found that many of those ideas, I had already read them in documents of the bishops, Filipino bishops. I already mentioned the sample document in Japan. And then other topics in PCP2 and so on. So I asked permission from the CBCB to reproduce some of those documents, which for many Filipinos is a rediscovery. Those documents we are reading about 15, 20 years ago, forgotten. This is an opportunity to revisit them, to read them attentively and say, look at that. Our bishop already speaking about this 20 years ago. What have we done about it? And so on. So, likewise, concerning, yes, concerning, yeah, Amoris Laetitia. Amoris Laetitia. Here I ask again permission to reprint. The study aids what is happening to our beautiful land. I reproduce it, and that is 14 pages. Then safeguarding the environment. Again, another very beautiful pastoral letter. See, this is, I could not write something like this in Lumen Fide. The topic here would demand, and there is enough material to show that we already have something of our own. Why, as I told you earlier, Lumen Fide, I made that research about the faith in the Bible, and it is extremely enlightening and enriching. But that was my reflection. Make your own. As you read the Bible, develop the topic of faith. Guide about the Benedict XVI says, read those portions of the Bible that himself quotes or refers to, and see what they tell you. That is part of the owning process, assimilation process, which we should all undergo, and our people should undergo. Even a child should undergo that process. But using a language, using images, using practical exercises that are relevant and doable by people of that age, that the person experienced, that problematic, and so on. So the importance of paying attention to your audience. It has so many. Every audience is different. And a good facilitator is good to the extent that he or she knows one's own audience. Other components of the study aids, okay, just to show you again, sometimes is something that I would never like to do. I did that in Laudato Si, because many paragraphs were very long and different subtopics inside. What I did was to cut down and to write here, portion by portion, a very short summary of what that series of lines is all about. Many people found that very helpful. I tell you, it was a torture even for the guy laying out the book, no? He had to put a line to this point, not up or down, and try it again, because then the text runs and so on. But in the end, it comes out something that is very useful. So as you open the book, you find it in what chapter we are. Then here you have the little summary, which is very, very helpful. Very helpful indeed. Okay, this is what I wanted to tell you. Monsignor told me that I should talk about Article 9:15. It is 9:16 and a half. Okay, before I brought with me copies of Exploring God's Word. Are you familiar with this publication? Exploring God's Word? Silence.
Yes.
Who is? Raise your hand if you are. You are all. Okay, I will tell you something later on. But before then, I would like to hear from you now. You may have a question to ask, clarification to ask and to receive. Okay, so I stop talking, you start. Any questions? Yes.
This with regards to the apostolic exhortation of Pope Francis, Amoris Laetitia, because recently there was, I think, a controversy with regards to the document when there were some cardinals who were questioning some portions of the document, particularly with regards to the divorce and the remarried whether they are allowed to receive communion or not. And I do not know if the clarifications were already done by the Holy Father. And can you enlighten us on the matter?
Well, I'm not privy to what the Holy Father may have answered. I understand they did not answer. They did not answer those. Well, first of all, the ones who objected are four cardinals, I understand, or two are cardinals. Anyway, they were four, and they were in a way, they are clearly cardinals or archbishops of the very legal frame mind. I want to know, is it right or wrong, allowed or not allowed, no? Which is a legalistic approach. Pope Francis does not belong to that school. Is much more for compassion, for understanding. And so sometimes it comes out with some statements which to the legal mind people is, that's confusing. Why does it not state clearly this and that? You know? So they would never like the Holy Father to have written these things clearly already. Since he did not, then he suggested, Your Holiness, please correct these passages. And they gave the passages. And then it appears that the Holy Father, after consulting his counselors, decided not to answer. And since no answer was coming, those cardinals said, since Your Holiness did not correct, we take it upon ourselves to correct what you said, which is not a very respectful way to speak of, to the Holy Father. No? But it is it's a problem. No? I myself, when I read it, this can be ambiguous, some people can misinterpret it. You know? But when you speak in an act of compassion, understanding the dramas of some cases, you know, yes, they are divorced. Then what has brought about that divorce? Sometimes one is a victim, and the other is the victimizer. It appears legally that we are treating the victim and the victimizer on the same way, in the same way. What if one has been forced to divorce, and he or she has a family to raise, and meets another person of the opposite sex? That seems to get along well. And they live together. They cannot anymore get married officially for the church they are married. They cannot be divorced because for the church there is no divorce. But they are getting along well. They want to raise their children as Christians. Can we allow these people to receive communion or not? That's bottom line in the end. Or shall we say, no, sorry, you are not married in the church, so you cannot receive communion. Well, legally, that has been the procedure of the church for many generations. Pope Francis, in a way, is somehow questioning that. Maybe it requires discernment, and then leaves it to the local bishop to discern in talking to the people concerned. All that was not contemplated in the Code of Canon. But the Pope is show comprehension, show understanding, talk it out, make them realize how they reach that point, and how they can still serve the Lord, and feel still part of the Christian community. I think that was the line of the Pope. For some people, that is unacceptable because they belong to that particular school. It may really create sometimes difficulties because ordinary people feel confused. Oh, there are a lot of money in church and going to see the communion. So it's all the same. They would draw that wrong conclusion. It's not all the same, the Pope says. There is the ideal. That everybody should try to attain, to reach. And the Pope is very strong to that. That is the idea. But what if one falls short of that idea? Shall we reject that person? And that is the compassion. That is the compassion of Christ. From questions. And I don't think I can express a definitive answer, but there are questions we have to grapple with. There is the law, and we need the law. Without law, there is chaos. But the law has to be interpreted with the heart of those, having in mind the compassion of Christ. who scandalized many people of his time, precisely because he was doing something that was not contemplated by the law. Healing people on the Sabbath. Allowing a prostitute to touch him. According to the law observers, that's wrong, or that's not a prophet, and so on. And yet Christ is a believer in peace. The law says, let the adulterers be stoned. They bring it to him. Okay, now, she was caught in adultery, what's your opinion? And Jesus would have said, well, take it upon yourselves. If you are sinless, let the first one without sin, let the one who is not sin be the first to throw the stone. You see, his compassion towards that poor lady, yes, she was a sinner. And yet, the compassion in Jesus, you know, overruled what the law said. What's more important? The law is needed, but the law should not be used to torment people. And Pope Francis has a lot to say when it comes also to confession, that the confessional should not be transformed into torture chambers. And sometimes some confessors do that. Unfortunately, Pope Francis belongs to the school of